On this first day, first full day of spring, we gather here this morning to lift up the holy name of God. Let us have our call to worship. O come and worship, we are a product of your workmanship. O come and worship, we pause to reflect on all your goodness. O come and worship, I was glad when they invited me into the house of the Lord. O come and worship, this is a day of praise. O come and worship. Let us bow our heads now for our invocation. You are welcome in this place. You are Father, you are Son, you are the Holy Spirit. We await your anointing as we have gathered to give you praise and honor. You are welcome in this place. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost we pray. Amen. Let us blend our voices together in our hymn of praise this morning. Oh, how I love Jesus.
Love.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now reverently and sincerely declare by use of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning can be found in Hebrews, the 5th chapter. We'll be reading in your hearing verses 5 through 10. So also Christ did glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he has said unto another place, "For you are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obeyed him. Having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. This is the word of God for the people of God, and it has already been blessed. Amen. As we pray, as we prepare to go before the Lord, we'll have a hymn of prayer, praise before the morning prayer.
Listen while you still can hear. Listen while you still can hear the Master's calling. The Master's calling. Bow down while your knees still bend. Bow down while your knees still bend. The Master's calling. The Master's calling. Away from him. No, I don't wanna run and walk away from him.
bind me to your side. Listen while your ears still hear. Listen while your ears still hear. The Master's calling. The Master's calling. Yeah, the Master's calling. The Master's calling. The Master's calling. The Master's calling.
Listen while you still can hear the Master calling. In order for us to hear the Master calling, we have to learn how to slow ourselves down, center ourselves, and know the voice of God. So God, we come this morning, shutting out the world, shutting out all the concerns that are always coming and going in our lives, all the hustle and the bustle, all the moving and the going. And God, our minds are solely focused on you, focused on your goodness, your greatness, your grace, your mercy, your love, your provision, your protection, even the ability, God, to forgive us for all the places where we need to be forgiven. God, you're such a great and awesome God. And we count it a privilege, God, to be able to kneel before you, whether it's physically or spiritually. We humble ourselves as we enter into your holy presence, God, realizing, God, that we're not worthy, but God, you love us enough that you allow us to have direct access to you. So God, thank you for this chance just to once again call upon your name. This chance, God, to thank you for being our Father and our friend. Thank you, God, for being our Savior and our Redeemer. Thank you, God, for being our Counselor and our Advocate. God, you are so many things to us. And God, we don't have enough time or enough tongues to say how awesome and great you are. But God, please accept these feeble words of adoration, God. They're not enough for the one who spoke and time became time. They're not enough for the one who spoke and light separated from darkness. It's not enough for the one who spoke and there were birds and there were fish and even humans. You are awesome, God, in so many ways, God, and we've come just to adore you. God, thank you for being with us this past week, even when we didn't realize you were with us, even when we were stuck on ourselves and stuck in our own minds and stuck on our own situations, God, you were with us. And so, God, thank you for being with us. We thank you, God, for what you did for us this past week, but not just what you did this past week, but what you've done all our lives, God. You're a good God, and we give your name praise. God, there are some who are in this broadcast today, in this worship experience, God, who need a touch from you. God, they need a healing touch from you. They're going through something in their body, and they need your touch, God. We pray that you would go to them, go to their body, go to their mind, go to their spirit, God. Somebody needs you, God, in their home. Somebody, God, needs you in their relationship. Somebody needs you on the job. Somebody needs a job, God, and they need you to step in. Somebody needs you, God, to fill up the storehouse for them, God, so that they might have food to eat and they might have funds, God, to take care of the essentials. Somebody needs to be reminded, God, that you are still working things out in the midst of this pandemic. If we would but let you have your way. God, we pray that you would be with the Lomax Church family, as well as the whole kingdom of God. That God, we would do what you tell us to do, and we would go where you tell us to go. We would be the people that you want us to be. So God, we yield ourselves to you. We ask you, God, that you would have your way in this worship service. Take us out of self and allow us to focus on you, God, and worshiping you in spirit and in truth. God, come and continue to have your way in everything that will happen, not just today, but in the days and weeks to come as we continue to walk with you. God, we love you. God, we praise you. And it's in the matchless name of Jesus, who is the Christ, we pray. Let everybody say with uplifted voices, amen, amen, and amen.
Thank you, Pastor, for that fervent prayer. Amen. Opportunity has now presented itself for us to give back to the Lord a portion of that which he has given to us in our resources. There are many in this time and this period of illness around the world who don't have to give. But thanks be to God for the opportunity that what he has given us, we're able to give back to him a portion thereof to be used for the upbuilding of his kingdom. You may be able to give by Giblify. The access point is on your screen at this time. You also may be able to give via U.S. Postal Service and the snail mail to the Lomax Church. We ask that you give liberally because there are many in need and they often come to the storehouse for those needs. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for we know you to be the provider. And in what you have given us, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to give back. We pray, Heavenly Father, that these gifts will be blessed. We pray that these gifts will be multiplied and that they will be used not for our own worth, but, Lord, for the upbuilding of your kingdom. Bless the gift. Bless the giver. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those who wanted to give but had it not. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you will touch their sources, Lord, that when the opportunity arises, that they may also be able to give. This we ask in the name of the Father, Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. Amen. Our musical ministry will come to us again with a hymn of preparation.
You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I can be whole, so I can tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I can be free, so I can be whole, so I can tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I can be free, so I can be whole, so I can tell everyone I know. Hallelujah. I worship forever your glory forever, because I am free, because I am whole, and I will tell everyone I know. Hallelujah. Glory to the God who changed my life, and I will praise you forever, worship forever, I'll give you glory forever, forever, because I am free, because I am whole,
and I will tell everyone I know.
Hallelujah, glory
to the God who changed my life, and I will praise
forever,
worship
forever.
Saving, ooh. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I can be free.
Sometimes when you just think about the fact that our God came down just to die for me, it's overwhelming to think about what that means. That he loved me that much, that he died for me. We couldn't thank him enough. We couldn't praise him enough. If you would turn with me to Genesis, the 14th chapter, and we're going to begin reading in verse number 14. Genesis 14, beginning in verse 14. When Abram heard that his nephew had been taken captive, he led forth his trained men born in his house, 318 of them, and went in pursuit as far as Dan. He divided his forces against them by night, he and his servants, and routed them and pursued them to Hobah, north of Damascus. Then he brought back all the goods and also brought back his nephew, Lot, with his goods, and the women and the people. Verse 17. After his return from the defeat of Chedorlaomer and the kings who were with him, the king of Sodom went out to meet him at the valley of Shaveh. That is the king's valley. And King Melchizedek of Salem brought out bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High. He blessed him and said, "Blessed be Abram by God Most High, maker of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand." And Abram gave him one-tenth of everything. Then the king of Sodom said to Abram, "Give me the persons, but take the goods for yourself." But Abram said to the king of Sodom, "I have sworn to the Lord, God Most High, maker of heaven and earth, that I would not take a thread or a sandal thong or anything that is yours, so that you might not say, 'I have made Abram rich.' I will take nothing but what the young men have eaten and the share of the men who went with me, Aner, Eshol, and Mamre. Let them take their share."
Amen.
Won't you pray with me? Lord God, thank you for once again this day, this worship experience, this opportunity to reconnect with you, but more importantly, to receive a word from you. And so, God, we pray that you would now show up in this preaching moment. We pray, God, that you would fill in all the rough places and smooth out all the crooked places, that you would have your way so that your people could receive what you intended for them to receive. And now we pray, God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart are acceptable to thee, Lord, for you are my strength and my redeemer. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. On Friday, a volcano in Iceland that had been dormant for 6,000 years erupted. That's right, 6,000 years this volcano had had no volcanic activity. But what we know about volcanoes is that you can't judge what's going on the inside of a volcano by what you see on the outside of a volcano. But what is the true indicator of volcanic activity is what is going on the inside. According to NASA, a volcano is an opening on the surface of a planet or a moon that allows material that is warmer than its surroundings to escape from its interior. So in the case of a volcano in the Earth, it's an opening in the Earth's crust through which lava and volcanic ash and gas escape. Most volcanoes form at the boundaries of where the Earth's tectonic plates come together, these slabs of the Earth's crust and upper mantle, which fit together like a puzzle. These plates are always moving, and volcanoes erupt in part when pressure builds up on the inside of the core of the volcano as the magma seeks to escape. With the volcano that erupted on Friday, there was something going on the inside of that volcano. For 6,000 years, pressure was building up. Magma was pushing its way to the surface, and there was no outward indicator that the volcano was about to erupt until it did. Yes, sometimes there is seismic activity that indicates that there's about to be an eruption. Sometimes a little smoke will come out of the volcano in a plume saying it's about to erupt. But sometimes there's no indication that the volcano is about to erupt. Our faith can be like the magma inside of a volcano. Our faith builds over time. It builds inside of us long before it is called to erupt forth like a volcano in our lives. However, at some point in our lives, when the pressures of life build up, maybe something seismic happens in our lives. As our lives are shifting like those tectonic plates, our faith that has been bubbling below the surface will erupt in response to the pressures of our lives. And so today I would ask you to consider the subject, when faith builds. When faith builds. Do you know that our faith is building even before we really know God? In fact, for the life of Abram, our central figure in our text today, we can see that it was possible for him to worship God before he really knew God. Our faith in God is building over time, and it's possible for us to engage in worship of God before we actually have a saving faith in who God is through Jesus Christ. Yes, while our faith is building, it's possible for us to worship God before you get to the place of being in relationship with God. But you may be wondering, as our faith is building, how can you worship God before you really know God? Paul records in Acts 7 that as he walked around Athens and looked carefully at the objects of worship he found there, that among them he found an altar with an inscription that said, "To the unknown God." Paul said, "What therefore you worshiped as unknown, this I proclaim to you." Each of us has a period of time in our lives where we worship an unknown God, as that God allows us to get to know him, and we begin to worship him. Maybe it's because our parents worship that God. Maybe it's because our friends and family worship that God, that we know that that God exists, but we don't really know that God. That God is unknown to us. And as our faith builds, I dare say that all of us have worshiped this unknown God before we actually knew this God. Look at Abram's story in Genesis. This unknown God called Abram to leave his country, his clan, and his kindred to go to the land that God would show him. Abram was 75 years old when he began to journey with this unknown God. Some of us begin our journey with this unknown God as infants, having grown up in Christian homes and the church all of our lives, while others of us begin the journey with this unknown God as youth, as young adults, even as adults, as situations in our life begin to arise that compel us to search for something that's bigger than ourselves. Even as the pressures of life build and we're looking for something bigger than ourselves, to put our trust and our faith in. However, at some point in our life, we at least acknowledge that there is a God that is unknown to us, and we begin to journey with this unknown God. It doesn't mean that we are committed to this God at this point, but we're simply beginning our journey with this unknown God. It would seem that Abraham first heard the voice of an unknown God while his family was living in Haran. Scripture does not indicate that before God spoke to Abraham, as is recorded in Genesis 12, that Abram knew of God. But whatever transpired between God and Abram, it captured Abram's attention enough for Abram to take his family, including his wife Sarah, his nephew Lot, and his servants, to pick up their lives, to leave their familiar homeland, to leave their family, to leave Abram's father's house, and to go to a land that God would show Abram. There's no doubt that Abram's first steps of faith were faith in an unknown God. Do you remember when you took your first steps of faith with this unknown God? I might not have been one who took a step of faith as big as Abram took, but it nonetheless was a step of faith, a step of faith that at least required us to acknowledge the voice of this unknown God. We sang about hear him while there's still yet time. We're beginning to hear the voice of God, and he's beginning to reveal God's self to us. This unknown God was building your faith in God's voice, your faith in following God's commands, and your faith in believing in God's promises. Church, the first thing we see in the life of Abram is this. When faith builds, you can worship God before you know God. Again, look at Abram. Abram didn't know God before God called him. Abram was living in a foreign land before this unknown God called him to believe in the promises of God. Is there anybody here that's willing to admit that even when you began your journey with God, you really didn't know God? Yes, you went to Sunday school, but you really didn't know God. You participated in the church Christmas and Easter plays, but you really didn't know God. You even owned a Bible, and you sometimes might read it, but you really didn't know God. You went to church, but you didn't really know God. You even sang in the choir, but you really didn't know God. You just liked the song, you liked the music, and so you wanted to sing, but you really didn't know God. Like Abram, early in our journey with God, we can worship God when we really don't even know God. In Genesis 12:6, we see that Abram, before he really knew God, the Lord appeared to him by an oak of Moreh, and Abram built an altar to the Lord where the Lord had appeared to him. Abram worshiped God, but Abram didn't really know God at this point in his journey with God. Abram was just getting to know God, but Abram didn't really know him. And so every time that he had an encounter with God, if we were to take time and to search the scriptures, you will see that every time he came into contact with this God, that he would build an altar where he encountered God. Because Abram was learning to worship God before he really knew God. He was getting to know God. As one commentary notes, worship was obviously an integral part of Abram's life. Abram's altar building was in part a personal act which showed gratitude for the Lord. It was Abram's worshipful response to the Lord, showing that God had done something in his life. I don't know who this message is for today, but God wants someone to know that when faith builds, you can worship God even before you know God. Building faith in God is like building little altars each and every time God shows up some kind of way in your life, and you know that it's God before you've come to know who God is. You build an altar when each time God helps you pass the test in school, but you really don't know the God that you pray to. You build an altar when God protected you from that bully, but you really didn't know the God that protected you. You build an altar when you got in some trouble that no one else knows about but you and God, but God got you out of it, so you built a little altar. You build an altar when God provided for you, and you really didn't understand where your provision was coming from, but you built a little altar to God. God says to us today, you can be in church all your life. You can serve in the church. You can even worship God Sunday after Sunday after Sunday and still not really know God. And so when faith builds, you can worship God before you know God. Yes, when faith builds, you can sing to God before you really know God. When faith builds, you can play instruments to God before you really know God. But something is going on the inside, like the magma of a volcano. There's a pressure building. There's something seismic going on in your life. And at some point, that faith is going to erupt in your life. Yeah, yeah. As Abram continues to journey with this unknown God, a God that Abram is getting to know, Abram experiences what we would like to call a situation in his life. I want to suggest to you that Abram experienced something in his life that would build his faith and shape the rest of his life. In Genesis 13 and 14, it records that Abram and his nephew Lot decided that it would be better for their relationship and their respective families if Abram and his huge household, his flocks and his servants went one way, and Lot and his huge family and his flocks and his servants went another way. Conflicts were starting to arise between Uncle Abram and nephew Lot. Family were cohabitating on the same land, and some strife was coming about, and so Lot was given the option to choose the land that he would take his family to. And Lot chose to head east with his people. And Abram chose to settle in the land of Canaan. If you want to read all about it, read it in Genesis 13. Here's the thing. The eastern lands that Lot chose included the city of Sodom on its perimeter. Scripture says in Genesis 13:13 that the people of Sodom were wicked, great sinners against the Lord. I want to suggest to you that as we journey with this unknown God, before we know this God, there comes a time when we have to decide whether we're going to go and dwell in the land of the Lord or we're going to dwell with sinners. Scripture records that Abram gave Lot the choice of the land, and Lot chose the land that included Sodom, which was inhabited by wicked people who were great sinners against the Lord. Thanks be to God that Abram came to dwell in the land of the Lord, which was in Canaan, not in the eastern lands where Sodom could be found, this place of great wickedness, this place where the great sinners of the Lord, because Lot's location in Sodom had some major consequences in his life. Today, maybe there is somebody who needs to be reminded that even if you don't know God, as you journey with God, Don't dwell in the land where there's great wickedness and among people who sin greatly against God. Can I remind you what Psalm 1 says? Oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers. That's folks who make fun of those who know the Lord. But their delight is in the law of the land, meditating on it day and night. You got to dwell in the land where God is. They are like trees planted along the riverbank, bearing fruit each season. Their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. But not the wicked. They are like worthless chaff scattered by the wind. They will be condemned at the time of judgment. Sinners will have no place among the godly, for the Lord watches over the paths of the godly, but the path of the wicked leads to destruction. We got a choice to make. Are we going to go east into the land where the wicked and the sinners are? Are we going to go into the land of the Lord where God can be found and he will allow you to prosper? Yes, church, we locate ourselves, and where we locate ourselves has consequences. Our associations have consequences. For if we locate ourselves in wicked places with sinful people, there will be consequences. And so Lot went eastward towards sin, and Abram went the opposite direction towards the promises of God. Genesis 13:18 records that after walking Canaan, Abram settled by the oaks of Mamre, and he built an altar to the Lord. Here he goes again, building altars to the Lord. Abram's faith was building in this unknown God, and Abram built another altar so that he could worship the God that he was getting to know. Abram's faith was building in this unknown God who had resolved his dispute with Lot. Abram's faith was building in this unknown God who had given him the choice land in Canaan, a down payment on the promises of God. Abram's faith was building in this unknown God who had preserved Abram from living in wicked places among sinful people. Yes, Abram's faith was building in this unknown God. Maybe your faith is building as you think about when this unknown God resolved some family disputes in your life, or kept you notwithstanding the dysfunctional and abusive family that you grew up in. Maybe your faith is building as you think about this unknown God who made good little by little on the promises that God had made in your life. Maybe your faith is building as you think about this unknown God who protected you from wicked places and sinful people. Church, do you know that God is a keeper? Do you know that because Lot was living in Sodom, a wicked place with sinful people, he found himself being captured in a battle that's recorded in Genesis 14. Sometimes living in wicked places, sometimes hanging out with wicked people, will cause you to be captured and will be separated from God. Look at what happened to Lot. And it was this life event, it was this situation in Abram's life that caused his faith to go to a new level. In Genesis 14:14, we see Abram got word that his nephew Lot had been captured. Abram mobilized men from his household to fight against the army that had captured Lot. It isn't believed that Abram was a military man who had much might. It isn't believed that his army was so big. It isn't believed that Abraham should have won this conflict. But God. See, when God shows up in your life and in your situation, it makes all the difference. And Abram won the battle, and he was able to free Lot. And it's here we find our second point. When faith builds, you will encounter God in a life-changing way. When faith builds, you will encounter God in a life-changing way. See, in verse 17 of our text, we find one of the most debated pericopes of Scripture, which is what caught my spiritual attention this week. Here we are introduced to a priest king by the name of Melchizedek. Melchizedek is both a priest and the king of Salem. Scholars note that Melchizedek is a mysterious figure mentioned only in Genesis 14, in Psalm 110, and in Hebrews 5 through 7. And we learn that in Psalm 110, it says that Melchizedek is a priest forever, an eternal priest. And Hebrews speaks of Jesus as being a priest like Melchizedek of eternal nature. The name Melchizedek means my king is salvation, or my king is righteousness. Verse 18 describes Melchizedek as a priest of God Most High. And so there are those who believe that Melchizedek, this mysterious priest king, from Salem — you do know that Salem is another name for Jerusalem — this strange priest king was a part of the never-ending eternal priesthood, that it was actually Jesus pre-incarnate. That's what some scholars believe. In other words, Abram may have been having an encounter with Jesus before Jesus actually put on flesh. Yeah, anybody who's ever had an encounter with Jesus, don't you know that it changes your life forever? That your faith will never be the same when you actually come in contact with Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
I meant to look at our text and want you to note that this Melchizedek was in the King's Valley. Mm-hmm. Who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords but Jesus? Melchizedek was this eternal priest king of the God Most High. And look at what he does. Our text says that he brings Abram bread and wine. Mm-hmm. That's right. Melchizedek brings Abram both bread and wine. Folks, you do know we are in the Old Testament here. Anybody here know anything about what bread and wine is significant of? What it symbolizes to those of us who are followers of Jesus Christ? Yes, this bread and wine was offered to Abram as a form of hospitality. But it cannot be a coincidence that this Jesus-like priest king comes to offer Abram bread and wine. It would seem from our text that Abram is having a life-changing, a life-altering encounter with God through the preformed existence of Jesus Christ. Abram wasn't supposed to have won that fight, but God showed up. Abram's nephew Lot was rescued because God showed up. Abram's nephew's fortunes were recovered because God showed up. And if it was not just enough of that, then God shows up in the form of this priest king and says, I'm going to bless you.
Yeah.
In verse 19, Melchizedek blessed Abram with this blessing: blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. I don't know about you, but I only know one God Most High. I only know one creator of the heavens and the earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has defeated your enemies for you. It's right there in verse number 19. It was God who defeated Abram's enemies. It was God who freed Lot. He did it just for me. Wait a minute. What would have happened if God hadn't shown up in their situation? There were some promises that were riding on this whole thing, some promises that God had made to Abraham way back at the beginning, before Abraham even knew he was Abraham, before Abram even knew who God was. I don't know about you, but it gets me excited to think about this priest, this king, this Melchizedek, this eternal one, showing up in the life of Abram, offering him bread and wine, even in the Old Testament. Abram had been on this journey with this unknown God, and this representative of this unknown God had come to meet him in the King's Valley and to bless him. Abram had worshiped this unknown God, but Abram now realized that it was this unknown God who'd been keeping him all along. Yes, Abram is having an encounter with this Jesus-like figure who stands to bless him in the name of God Most High, who offers him bread and wine. Bread that represents Israel's liberation from bondage in Egypt. It hadn't even happened yet, but it was foreshadowing it. Bread that would represent manna in the wilderness. You know, he does free us from bondage and take us through the wilderness. Bread that would represent the bread of life. That's what Jesus said he was. And bread that would represent Christ's broken body on Calvary's tree. You gotta have faith to be able to see it. Wine that would represent the four cups of the Passover Seder that God will bring you out. The cup that God will deliver you, the cup that God will redeem you, and the cup that God will take you out. Wine that would represent the bitter cup that Jesus had to drink. Wine that would represent Christ spilled blood on Calvary's tree. And wine that would represent eternal life for those who believe in God through Jesus Christ. When faith builds, it is when we have a life-changing encounter with Jesus. And an acknowledgement of this life-changing encounter, we see in verse 20, it says that Abram gave Melchizedek a tenth of all the goods he had recovered when he rescued Lot from Lot's captors. Melchizedek had blessed Abram, and Abram responded to the blessings and the encounter by giving him a tenth, which was a major act of worship in Abram's life. But what was more major in terms of Abram's encounter with Melchizedek is the fact that when you read the text, it says that the king of Sodom told Abram that he could keep the spoils of war. And Abram said, absolutely not. He said, I don't want it being said that you, the king of Sodom, made me rich. Abram was absolutely clear that all credit needed to go to God Most High, who sent his eternal priest king to bless him. I don't know about you, but when you have a personal encounter with God, you can't keep it to yourself, and you want to give him credit for what he's done for your life. The magna of faith was moving in Abram's life, and he was beginning to speak out and share that it was none but God who moved in my life. I don't want you to get it twisted that you did anything for me. It was God who showed up in my life. And so when faith builds, it's because we've had a life-altering encounter with God. Yes, Abram's faith was building from worshiping an unknown God to having an encounter with Melchizedek, this king and member of the eternal priesthood, to whom he gave a tithe for all that God had done for him, for the ways that God had blessed him. But then we see our third and final point. When faith builds, your faith must become sight. Can I say it again? When your faith builds, your faith must become sight. When you look at our text, I've always wondered how it came that Abram began to have faith in the promises of God. Look at Genesis chapter 15, verse 6. Come over one chapter with me. Verse 6 is where it says, and he, Abram, believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Genesis 15, 6 is the verse of scripture that is used as the foundation that our faith in God is our faith that makes us righteous. In other words, we can't earn our own righteousness. We only become righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ. And we have to believe in who God is and what the promises of God are in order for us to be deemed righteous. Well, how did Abram get to this point? Because verse 6 just kind of comes out of nowhere. He's had this encounter with Melchizedek. And at the beginning of chapter 15, it says, after these things, Abram had this moment where he was still wondering whether God would deliver on the promises. Because he said, look, God, you told me that I would have all these heirs. I would have all these descendants. But I have no son. Am I going to have an heir from my household, one of my servants? And God said, no. I will give you an heir from your own seed. He was having a moment where he was doubting. Has anybody been there in your faith walk where you've worshiped him from afar? You had an encounter with him, but sometimes you wonder whether or not God can really bring forth the promises that God has made to you. Well, Abram was in that point where it was time for him to put up or shut up. And God said, look, I want you to look at the sky. I want you to look at the stars. And if you can count the stars, those are all the descendants that I will give you. I know you're old. I know your wife is barren. I know you have no children right now. But I want you to remember that encounter that we had, that encounter that you had with Melchizedek, that encounter where he showed up in your life and you won the battles that you weren't supposed to win. And that is why I believe that all of a sudden, in verse 6 of Genesis 15, that all of a sudden his faith became sight. You've got to be able to see it before it happens. No, there was nothing written in a contract. No, there was no telescope that he had to see the future. But faith was building inside of him, and that magna was growing inside of him. And all of a sudden, it erupted, and he said, I believe what you say to me, God. Is there anybody out there that's been in that situation where it seemed like all hope was lost? It seemed like there was no way you were going to make it. It seemed like God couldn't do anything, but something began to build up in your life like magna, and all of a sudden the faith began to flow out of you, and you began to say, God, I believe what you said. God, I believe you're going to do what you said you're going to do. When faith builds, it must become sight. It's not enough to talk about it. We got to walk in it. We got to bathe in it. We got to believe it. When faith becomes sight, that's where we get credit for God, and that's where God can show up in your life. How many times did people show up to be healed, and God said, your faith has made you whole? You just reached out and touched the hem of his garment, because your faith has to become sight. And so this day, maybe you're at the stage where you've just been walking around and you know God's in your life, but you've not had an encounter with him. This message is for you. And maybe if you're at the stage where you've had an encounter with God, but you've not actualized your faith, and maybe you're in the place where you need to be reminded that if you just trust God and what God has promised you, if you just believe that he said it, and so it is. If you just believe, when your faith builds, it will bubble out of you, and your faith will become sight. When faith builds. Let's pray. God, thank you for being with us even before we know who you are. We call that your prevenient grace. The grace that goes before us when we're walking around and we don't really know you. We hear you, but we don't really know you. There may be somebody out there today who's been resting in your prevenient grace and they don't even know it. They're not in relationship with you, but you've been keeping them for this very moment. All you need to do is say that I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that he died. I believe that he got up on the third day. And I believe that he is coming back for his people. If that's you today, then you now have gone from the place of prevenient grace to God's sanctifying grace, where you have justifying grace, where you have now been pardoned from all your sins. They're no more. God has wiped them away. You had an encounter with him through Jesus Christ, and so we celebrate if that's you on today. Maybe your faith was getting a little shaky this week, and you needed to be reminded of what God has done for you, and that you needed to make your faith sight. If that's you today, won't you give God praise and glory that he stepped into your situation, maybe even around your kitchen table, or as you lay in the bed, he knew what you needed, and he stepped in to tell you that all I need you to do is believe the promises that I've made to you. And then if you are worshiping with us today and you don't have a church home, Lomax, the building may not be open, but the church is open. And we're available to receive you if you would just reach out to us so that we can begin to teach you and walk with you along this journey. God, thank you for reminding us about the building of our faith. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
That gives me strength from day to day, and will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain. It flows
and minds are on one accord, we will receive our benediction. When faith builds. And now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, to keep you even when you don't know him, unto the all-wise God, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. And let the people of God say, amen.